The two young English officers were convinced that Ruiz was mad. How do you say that? Tile, Luce. But the doctor, an observant Scotsman with much shrewdness and philosophy and character, told me that it was a very curious case of possession. I met him many years afterwards, but he remembered the experience very well. He told me, too, that in his opinion, that woman did not lead Gaspar Ruiz into the practice of sanguinary treachery by direct persuasion, but by the subtle way of awakening and keeping alive in his simple mind a burning sense of an irreparable wrong. Maybe, maybe. But I would say that she poured half of her vengeful soul into the strong clay of that man, as you may pour intoxication, madness, poison, into an empty cup. If he wanted war, he got it in earnest when our victorious army began to return from Peru. Systematic operations were planned against this blot on the honor and prosperity of our hardly won independence. General Robles commanded with his well-known ruthless severity. Savage reprisals were exercised on both sides, and no quarter was given in the field. Having won my promotion in the Peru campaign, I was a captain on the staff. Gaspar Ruiz found himself hard-pressed. At the same time, we heard by means of a fugitive priest who had been carried off from his village presbytery and galloped 80 miles into the hills to perform the christening ceremony that a daughter was born to them. To celebrate the event, I suppose, Ruiz executed one of two brilliant forays clear away at the rear of our forces, and defeated the detachment sent out to cut off his retreat. General Robles nearly had a stroke of apoplexy from rage. He found another cause of insomnia than the bites of mosquitoes. But against this one, senors, tumblers of raw brandy had no more effect than so much water. He took to railing and storming at me about my strong man, and from our impatience to end this inglorious campaign, I am afraid that we young officers became reckless and apt to take undue risks on service. Nevertheless, slowly, inch by inch, as it were, our columns were closing upon Gaspar Ruiz, though he had managed to raise all the Araucanian nation of wild Indians against us. Then a year or more later, our government became aware, through its agents and spies, that he had actually entered into alliance with Carreras, the so-called dictator of the so-called Republic of Mendoza, on the other side of the mountains. Whether Gaspar Ruiz had a deep political intention or whether he wished only to secure a safe retreat for his wife and child while he pursued remorselessly against us his war of surprises and massacres, I cannot tell. The alliance, however, was a fact. Defeated in his attempt to check our advance from the sea, he retreated with his usual swiftness, and preparing for another hard and hazardous tussle, began sending his wife with the little girl across the Picuina range of mountains on the frontier of Mendoza. Now Carreras, under the guise of politics and liberalism, was a scoundrel of the deepest dye, and the unhappy state of Mendoza was the prey of thieves, robbers, traitors, and murderers who formed his party. He was under a noble exterior, a man without a heart, pity, honor, or conscience. Tai aspired to nothing but tyranny, and though he would have made a use of Gaspar Ruiz for his nefarious designs, yet he soon became aware that to propitiate the Chilean government he would answer his purpose better. I blush to say that he made proposals to our government to deliver up under certain conditions the wife and child of the man who had trusted to his honor, and that this offer was accepted. While on her way to Mendoza over the Picuina Pass, she was betrayed by her escort of Carrera's men and given up to the officer in command of a Chilean fort on the upland at the foot of the main Cordillera range. This atrocious transaction might have cost me dear, for as a matter of fact, I was a prisoner in Gaspar Ruiz's camp when he received the news. I had been captured during a reconnaissance, my escort of a few troopers being speared by the Indians of his bodyguard. I was saved from the same fate because he recognized my features just in time. No doubt, my friends, that I was dead, and I would not have given much for my life at any time. But the strong man treated me very well, because, he said, I had always believed in his innocence, and had tried to serve him when he was a victim of injustice. And now was his speech to me, "You shall see that I always speak the truth. You are safe." I did not think I was very safe when I was called up to go to him one night. He paced up and down like a wild beast, exclaiming, "Betrayed! Betrayed!" He walked up to me, clenched his fist. "I could cut your throat." "Will that give your wife back to you?" I said as quietly as I could. "And the child," he yelled out, as if mad. He fell into a chair and laughed in a frightful, boisterous manner. "Oh, no, you are safe." I assured him that his wife's life was safe, too. But I did not say what I was convinced of, that he would never see her again. He wanted war to the death, and the war could only end with his death. He gave me a strange, inexplicable look, and sat muttering blankly, in their hands. I kept as still as a mouse before a cat. Suddenly he jumped up. "What am I doing here?" he cried, and opening the door, he yelled out orders to saddle and mount. "What is it?" he stammered, coming up to me. "The Pequena Fort? A fort of palisades? Nothing. I would get her back here if she were hidden in the very heart of the mountain." He amazed me by adding, with an effort, "I carried her off in my two arms while the earth trembled, and the child at least is mine. She, at least, is mine." Those were bizarre words, but I had no time for wonder. "You shall go with me," he said violently. "I may want to parley, and any other messenger from Ruiz, the outlaw, would have his throat cut." This was true enough. Between him and the rest of incensed mankind, there could be no communications, according to the customs of honorable warfare. In less than half an hour, we were in the saddle, flying wildly through the night. He had only an escort of 20 men at his quarters, but would not wait for more. He sent, however, messengers to Panelio, the Indian chief then ranging in the foothills, directing him to bring his warriors to the uplands and meet him at the lake called the Eye of Water, near whose shores the frontier fort of Pequena was built. We crossed the lowlands with that untired rapidity of movement which had made Gaspar Ruiz's raids so famous. We followed the lower valleys up to their precipitous heads. The ride was not without its dangers. A cornice road on a perpendicular wall of basalt wound itself around a buttressing rock, and at last we emerged from the gloom of a deep gorge upon the upland of Peña. It was a plain of green wiry grass and thin flowering bushes, but high above our heads patches of snow hung in the folds and crevices of the great rocks. The little lake was as round as a staring eye. The garrison of the fort were just driving in their small herd of cattle when we appeared. Then the great wooden gate swung to, and that four-square enclosure of broad blackened stakes pointed at the top and barely hiding the grass roofs of the huts inside seemed deserted, empty, without a single soul. But when we summoned to surrender by a man who, at Gaspar's order, rode fearlessly forward, those inside answered by a volley which rolled him and his horse over. I heard Ruiz by my side grind his teeth. "It does not matter," he said. "Now you go." Torn and faded as its rags were, the vestiges of my uniform were recognized, and I was allowed to approach within speaking distance. And then I had to wait, because a voice clamoring through a loophole with joy and astonishment, would not allow me to place a word. It was the voice of Major Bajal, an old friend. He, like my other comrades, had thought me killed a long time ago. "Put spurs to your horse, man," he yelled in the greatest excitement. "We will swing the gate open for you." I let the reins fall out of my hands and shook my head. "I am on my honor," I cried. "To him?" he shouted with infinite disgust. "He promises you your life. Our life is our own, and do you, Santiera, advise us to surrender to that rastrero?" "No," I shouted, "but he wants his wife and child, and he can cut you off from water." "Then she would be the first to suffer. You may tell him that. Look here, this is all nonsense. We shall dash out and capture you." "You shall not catch me alive," I said firmly. "Imbecile! For God's sake," I continued hastily, "do not open the gate." And I pointed at the multitude of Pinelio's Indians who covered the shores of the lake. I had never seen so many savages together. Their lances seemed as numerous as stalks of grass. Their hoarse voices made a vast, inarticulate sound like the murmur of the sea. My friend Pajol was swearing to himself. "Well, then, go to the devil," he shouted, exasperated. But as I swung round, he repented, for I heard him say hurriedly, "Shoot the fool's horse before he gets away." He had got marksman. Two shots rang out, and in the very act of turning, my horse staggered, fell, and lay still as if struck by lightning. I had my feet out of the stirrups and rolled clear of him, but I did not attempt to rise. Neither dared they rush out and drag me in. The masses of Indians had begun to move upon the fort. They rode up in squadrons, trilling their long chusos, then dismounted out of musket shot, and throwing off their fur mantles, advanced naked to the attack, stamping their feet and shouting in cadence. A sheet of flame ran three times along the face of the fort without checking their steady march. They crowded right up to the very stakes, flourishing their broad knives. But this palisade was not fastened together with hide lashings in the usual way, but with long iron nails, which they could not cut. Dismayed at the failure of their usual method of forcing an entrance, the heathen, who had marched so steadily against the musketry fire, broke and fled under the volleys of the besieged. Directly they had passed me on their advance, I got up and rejoined Gaspar Ruiz on a low ridge which jutted out upon the plain. The musketry of his own men had covered the attack, but now at a sign from him a trumpet sounded the ceasefire. Together we looked in silence at the hopeless rout of the savages. "It must be a siege, then," he mustered, and I detected him wringing his hands stealthily. But what sort of siege could it be? Without any need for me to repeat my friend Pajol's message, he dared not cut the water off from the besieged. They had plenty of meat, and indeed, if they had been short, he would have been too anxious to send food into the stockade had he been able. But as a matter of fact, it was we on the plain who were beginning to feel the pinch of hunger. Pinelio, the Indian chief, sat by our fire, folded in his ample mantle of guanaco skins. He was an athletic savage with an enormous square shock head of hair resembling a straw beehive in shape and size, and with grave, surly, much-lined features. In his broken Spanish, he repeated, growling like a bad-tempered wild beast, that if an opening ever so small were made in the stockade, his men would march in and get that señora no otherwise. Gaspar Ruiz, sitting opposite him, kept his eyes fixed on the fort night and day, as it were, in awful silence and immobility. Meantime, by runners from the lowlands that arrived nearly every day, we heard of the defeat of one of his lieutenants in Marpu Valley. Scouts sent afar brought news of a column of infantry advancing through distant passes to the relief of the fort. They were slow, but we could trace their toilful progress up the lower valleys. I wondered why Ruiz did not march to attack and destroy this threatening force in some wild gorge fit for an ambuscade, in accordance with his genius for guerrilla warfare. But his genius seemed to have abandoned him to his despair. It was obvious to me that he could not tear himself away from the site of the fort. I protest to you, senors, that I was moved almost to pity by the sight of this powerless strong man sitting on the ridge, indifferent to sun, to rain, to cold, to wind, with his hands clasped round his legs and his chin resting on his knees, gazing, gazing, gazing. And the fort he kept his eyes fastened on was as still and silent as himself. The garrison gave no sign of life. They did not even answer the desultory fire directed at the loopholes. One night, as I strolled past him, he, without changing his attitude, spoke to me unexpectedly. "I have sent for a gun," he said. "I shall have time to get her back and retreat before your robles manages to crawl up here." He had sent for a gun to the plains. It was long in coming, but at last it came. It was a 7-pounder field gun, dismounted and lashed crosswise to 2 long poles. It had been carried up the narrow paths between 2 mules with ease. His wild cry of exultation at daybreak, when he saw the gun escort emerge from the valley, rings in my ears now. But, senors, I have no words to depict his amazement, his fury, his despair, and distraction when he heard that the animal loaded with the gun carriage had, during the last night march, somehow or other tumbled down a precipice. He broke into menaces of death and torture against the escort. I kept out of his way all that day, lying behind some bushes and wondering what he would do now. Retreat was left for him, but he could not retreat. I saw below me his artillerist, Jorge, an old Spanish soldier, building up a sort of structure with heaped-up saddles. The gun, ready loaded, was lifted onto that, but in the act of firing the whole thing collapsed and the shot flew high above the stockade. Nothing more was attempted. One of the ammunition mules had been lost, too, and they had no more than 6 shots to fire, amply enough to batter down the gate, providing the gun was well laid. This was impossible without it being properly mounted. There was no time nor means to construct a carriage. Already every movement I expected to hear Robles' bugle calls echo amongst the crags. Penelio, wandering about uneasily, draped in his skins, sat down for a moment near me, growling his usual tale. "Make an entrada, a hole. If make a hole, bueno. If not make a hole, then vamos, we must go." After sunset, I observed with surprise the Indians making preparations as if for another assault. Their lines stood ranged in the Shadows Mountains. On the plains in front of the fort gate, I saw a group of men swaying about in the same place. I walked down the ridge, disregarded. The moonlight and the clear air of the uplands was as bright as day, but the intense shadows confused my sight, and I could not make out what they were doing. I heard Jorge, artillerist, say, in a queer, doubtful tone, "It is loaded, senors." Then another voice in that group pronounced firmly the words, "Bring the riata here." It was the voice of Gaspar Ruiz. A silence fell in which the popping shots of the besieged garrison rang out sharply. They too had observed the group, but the distance was too great, and in the spatter of spent musket balls cutting up the ground, the group opened, closed, swayed, giving me a glimpse of busy stooping figures in midst. I drew near, doubting whether this was a weird vision, a suggestive and insensate dream. "Si, senor," several other voices answered in tones of awed alacrity. Then the stifled voice said, "Like this, I must be free to breathe." Then there was a concerned noise of many men together. "Help him up, hombres, steady, under the arm." That deadened voice ordered, "Bueno, stand away from me, men." I pushed my way through the recoiling circle and heard once more that same oppressed voice saying earnestly, "Forget that I am a living man, Jorge. Forget me altogether and think of what you have to do." "Be without fear, senor. You are nothing to me but a gun carriage, and I shall not waste a shot." I heard the spluttering of a port fire and smelt the saltpeter of the match. I saw suddenly before me a nondescript shape on all fours like a beast, with a man's head drooping below a tubular projection over the nape of the neck and the gleam of a rounded mass of bronze on its back. In front of a silent semicircle of men, it squatted alone, with Jorge behind it, and a trumpeter motionless, his trumpet in his hand, by its side. Jorge bent doubled, muttered, "Port fire in hand. An inch to the left, senor. Too much. So, now, if you let yourself down a little by letting your elbows bend, I will." He leaped aside, lowering his port fire, and a burst of flame darted out of the muzzle of the gun lashed on the man's back. Then Gaspar Ruiz lowered himself slowly. "Good shot?" he asked. "Full on, senor. Then load again." He lay there before me on his breast under the darkly glittering bronze of his monstrous burden, such as no love or strength of man had ever had to bear in the lamentable history of the world. His arms were spread out, and he resembled a prostrate penitent on the moonlit ground. Again I saw him raise to his hands and knees, and the men stand away from him, and old Jorge stoop, glancing along the gun. "Left a little, right an inch. Por Dios, senor, stop trembling. Where is your strength?" The old gunner's voice was cracked with emotion. He stepped aside, quick as lightning, brought the spark to the touch hole. "Excellent," he cried tearfully. But Gaspar Ruiz lay for a long time silent, flattened on the ground. "I am tired," he murmured at last. "Will another shot do it?" "Without doubt," said Jorge, bending down to his ear. "Then load," I heard him utter distinctly, "trumpeter." "I am here, senor, ready for your word." "Blow a blast at this word that shall be heard from one end of Chile to the other," he said in an extraordinarily strong voice. "And you others stand ready to cut this accursed riata, for then will be the time for me to lead you in your rush. Now raise me up, and you, Jorge, be quick with your aim." The rattle of musketry from the fort neatly drowned his voice. The palisade was wreathed in smoke and flame. "Exert your force forward against the recoil, mi amo," said the old gunner shakily. "Dig your fingers into the ground. So now." A cry of exultation escaped him after the shot. The trumpeter raised his trumpet nearly to his lips and waited, but no word came from the prostrate man. I fell on one knee and heard all he had to say then. "Something broken," he whispered, lifting his head a little and turning his eyes towards me in his hopelessly crushed attitude. "The gate hangs only by splinters," yelled Jorge. Gaspar Ruiz tried to speak, but his voice died out in his throat, and I helped to roll the gun off his back. He was insensible. I kept my lips shut, of course. The signal for the Indians to attack was never given. Instead, the bugle calls of the relieving force, for which my ears had thirsted so long, burst out, terrifying, like the call of the last day to our surprised enemies. "A tornado, senors, a real hurricane of stampeded men, wild horses, mounted Indians, swept over me as I cowered on the ground by the side of Gaspar Ruiz, still stretched out on his face in the shape of a cross. Benelio, galloping for life, jabbed at me with his long chuso in passing, for the sake of old acquaintance, I suppose. How I escaped the flying lead is more difficult to explain. Venturing to rise on my knees too soon, some soldiers in the 17th Taltal Regiment, in their hurry to get at something alive, nearly bayoneted me on the spot. They looked very disappointed, too, when some officers galloping up drove them away with the flat of their swords. It was General Robles with his staff. He wanted badly to make some prisoners. He, too, seemed disappointed for a moment. "What, is it you?" he cried. But he dismounted at once to embrace me, for he was an old friend of my family. I pointed to the body at our feet and said only these two words, "Gaspar Ruiz." He threw his arms up in astonishment. "Aha, you're strong man. Always to the last with your strong man. No matter. He saved our lives when the earth trembled enough to make the bravest faint with fear. I was frightened out of my wits. But he, no, qua gape. Where is the hero who got the best of him? Ha, ha, ha. What killed him, Chico?" "His own strength," I answered.
But as Gaspar Ruiz breathed yet, I had him carried in his poncho under the shelter of some bushes on the very ridge from which he had been gazing so fixedly at the fort, while unseen death was hovering already over his head. Our troops had bivouacked round the fort. Towards daybreak, I was not surprised to hear that I was designated to command the escort of a prisoner who was to be sent down at once to Santiago. Of course, the prisoner was Gaspar Ruiz's wife. "I have named you out of regard for your feelings," General Robles remarked, "though the woman really ought to be shot for all the harm she has done to the Republic." And as I made a movement of shocked protest, he continued, "Now he is as well as dead. She is of no importance. Nobody will know what to do with her. However, the government wants her." He shrugged his shoulders. "I suppose he must have buried large quantities of his loot in places that she alone knows of." At dawn, I saw her coming up the ridge, guarded by two soldiers, and carrying her child on her arm. I walked to meet her. "Is he living yet?" she asked, confronting me with that white, impassive face he used to look in an adoring way. I bent my head and led her round a clump of bushes without a word. His eyes were open. He breathed with difficulty and uttered her name with a great effort. "Herminia." She knelt at his head, the little girl, unconscious of him, with her big eyes looking about, began to chatter suddenly in a joyous, thin voice. She pointed a tiny finger at the rosy glow of sunrise behind the black shapes of the peaks, and while that child talk, incomprehensible and sweet to the ear, lasted, those two, the dying man and the kneeling woman, remained silent, looking into each other's eyes, listening to the frail sound. Then the prattle stopped. The child laid its head against its mother's breast and was still. "It was for you," he began. "Forgive." His voice failed him. Presently I heard a mutter and caught the pitiful words, "Not strong enough." She looked at him with an extraordinary intensity. He tried to smile, and in a humble tone, "Forgive me," he repeated, "leaving you." She bent down, dry-eyed, in a steady voice. "On all the earth I have loved nothing but you, Gaspar," she said. His head made a movement. His eyes revived. At last he sighed out. Then anxiously, "But is this true? Is this true?" "As true as that there is no mercy and justice in this world," she answered him passionately. She stooped over his face. He tried to raise his head, but it fell back, and when she kissed his lips, he was already dead. His glazed eyes stared at the sky. on which pink clouds floated very high, but I noticed the eyelids of the child, pressed to her mother's breast, drooped and closed slowly. She had gone to sleep. The widow of Gaspar Ruiz, the strong man, allowed me to lead her away without shedding a tear. For traveling, we had arranged for her a side saddle, very much like a chair, with a board swung beneath to rest her feet on. And the first day she rode without uttering a word, and hardly for one moment turning her eyes away from the little girl, whom she held on her knees. At our first camp I saw her during the night walking about, rocking the child in her arms, and gazing down at it by the light of the moon. After we had started on our second day's march, she asked me how soon we should come to the first village of the inhabited country. I said we should be there about noon. "And will there be women there?" she inquired. I told her that it was a large village. "There will be men and women there, Senora," I said, "whose hearts shall be made glad by the news that all the unrest and war is over now." "Yes, it is all over now," she repeated. Then after a time, "Senor officer, what will your government do with me?" "I do not know, Senora," I said. "They will treat you well, no doubt. We Republicans are not savages, and take no vengeance on women." She gave me a look at the word Republicans, which I imagined full of undying hate. But an hour or so afterwards, as we drew up to let the baggage mules go first along a narrow path, skirting a precipice, she looked at me with such a white, troubled face that I felt a great pity for her. "Senor officer," she said, "I am weak. I tremble. It is an insate fear." And indeed, her lips did tremble. While she tried to smile, glancing at the beginning of the narrow path, which was not so dangerous after all, "I am afraid I shall drop the child. Gaspar saved your life, you remember. Take her from me." I took the child out of her extended arms. "Shut your eyes, Senora, and trust your mule," I recommended. She did so, and with her pallor and her wasted thin face, she looked death-like. At a turn of the path, where a great crag of purple porphyry closes the view of the lowlands, I saw her open her eyes. I rode just behind her, holding the little girl with my right arm. "The child is all right," I cried encouragingly. "Yes," she answered faintly. And then, to my intense terror, I saw her stand up on the footrest, staring horribly, and throw herself forward into the chasm on our right. I cannot describe to you the sudden and abject fear that came over me at that dreadful sight. It was a dread of the abyss, the dread of the crags which seemed to nod upon me. My head swam. I pressed the child to my side, and sat my horse as still as a statue. I was speechless and cold all over. Her mule staggered, sliding close to the rock, and then went on. My horse only pricked up his ears with a slight snort. My heart stood still, and from the depths of the precipice, the stones rattling in the bed of the furious stream made me almost insane with their sound. Next moment we were round the turn and on a broad and grassy slope, and then I yelled. My men came running back to me in great alarm. It seems that at first I did nothing but shout, "She has given me the child into my hands. She has given the child into my hands." The escort thought I had gone mad. General Santierra ceased and got up from the table. "And that is all, senores," he concluded with a courteous glance at his rising guests. "But what became of the child, General?" we asked. "Ah, the child." He walked to one of the windows opening on his beautiful garden, the refuge of his old days. Its fame was great in the land. Keeping us back with a raised arm, he called out, "Erminia, Erminia," and waited. Then his cautioning arm dropped, and we crowded to the windows. From a clump of trees, a woman had come upon the boardwalk bordered with flowers. We could hear the rustle of her starched petticoats and observed the ample spread of her old-fashioned black silk skirt. She looked up, and seeing all these eyes staring at her, stopped, frowned, smiled, shook her finger at the general, who was laughing boisterously and drawing the black lace on her head so as to partly conceal her haughty profile, passed out of our sight, walking with stiff dignity. "You have beheld the guardian angel of the old man, and her to whom you owe all that is seemly and comfortable in my hospitality. Somehow, senors, though the flame of love has been kindled early in my breast, I have never married. And because of that, perhaps, the sparks of the sacred fire are not yet extinct." He struck his broad chest. "Still alive, still alive," he said with serio-comic emphasis. "But I shall not marry now. She is General Santiera's adopted daughter and heiress." One of our fellow guests, a young naval officer, described her afterwards as a short, stout old girl of 40 or thereabouts. We had all noticed that her hair was turning gray and that she had very fine black eyes. And General Santiera continued, "Neither would she ever hear of marrying anyone. A real calamity. Good, patient, devoted to the old man, a simple soul. But I would not advise any of you to ask for her hand, for if she took yours into hers, it would only be to crush your bones. Ah, she does not jest on that subject, and she is the own daughter of her father, the strong man who perished through his own strength, the strength of his body, of his simplicity, of his love."